Hello and welcome to our Facebook Live session today. It's a really special one because we've got two amazing people on. They're experts in the CEFR and the companion volume. Welcome to those of you who are joining us on Instagram as well. Unfortunately, we can't stream through one camera, so you'll find us looking a little bit in two directions at once. For those of you who are joining us on Instagram, unfortunately, we're not going to be able to respond to your questions immediately. So we've got monitors in the room today who will be looking at your comments as they come in. And any questions that we'll be able to answer today, they'll send through to us in this room and we'll answer them. For those of you joining us on Facebook, hello and welcome.
Hi, everyone.
let me introduce you to Dr. Nick Saville, who is our CEFR expert for the Council of Europe, and Dr. Hanan Khalifa, who is the companion volume expert for the Council of Europe. And today we are doing the essentials of the CEFR and the companion volume. So I guess the first question that everybody will ask is, what is the CEFR?
So hi, everybody. I'm Nick, as you've just heard, and I'd just like to welcome you all this afternoon and looking forward to having any of your questions to respond to. So please post them as we go along. Have a look at this screen, which we're just putting up now.
Uh-huh. We've lost it.
Can we get it?
We're getting it up now.
There we are. I wanted to show you this this picture of the Blue Book, which I think many of you will be familiar with. The Blue Book is the publication of the CEFR for languages, learning, teaching and assessment, which came out in 2001. It was actually the culmination of work dating back to the 1970s, but in particular, it was a publication which had its origins from about 1991 onwards. Its first edition was are we making any progress?
No, unfortunately, we are having a slight technical issue. The slides have decided to stop working.
Ah.
So it was working like 30 seconds ago. It's now not working.
Okay. Well, I mean, on the screen, I'm showing a picture of the CEFR volume from 2001. I was just commenting that it's published first in 1996 when I first got involved with it, and then later it appeared in many other translated and adapted versions around the world. It's designed to help language teaching, learning, assessment of all languages, and it promotes plurilingualism and lifelong learning generally. It's accompanied by what we call the toolkit, mm-hmm. and it has various other additions, which we have been seeing coming out regularly since 2001. One of them is the reference level descriptions for specific languages, including the one we've worked on called the English Profile Program, which is the CEFR for English.
And Nick, you mentioned the toolkit. People may or may not know what it is. Could you tell us a bit more about it, please?
Well, one of them is the latest companion volume, which we'll be coming on to. I'd just like to draw your attention to that, to the listeners. Actually, the first chapter, which is called Key Aspects of the CEFR for Teaching and Learning, pages 25 to 44, are a really good summary of the CEFR, its origins and its uses to date. It refers to some of the toolkit, which includes materials for people like ourselves, language assessment folk, a manual for aligning exams, a manual for developing examinations and tests. We have illustrative materials. We have grids for analyzing and categorizing materials by level. And as I mentioned before, we have the reference level descriptions projects for different languages, for Spanish, Italian, and so forth, and including English.
I heard you talk about the CEFR as a learning ladder. So a bit more on this, please.
Yeah, let's have a look at the next slide. Central to the CEFR is the reference level descriptors and the global scale of proficiency. The A1 to C2 bands, accompanied by illustrative scales couched in can-do terms, which we'll talk about later. As such, it allows us to align learning and assessment goals to the same curriculum and syllabus, which provides a learning ladder which can scaffold learning progression from a very early stage right the way to a very advanced stage, so from A1 to C2. And because it sort of locates the teaching learning assessment on the same plane, it allows the gradations of proficiency to be set and measured very accurately and communicated to all the participants. It also allows you not just to go from an early age all the way up in a continuous progression, but if you've hopped off of the ladder at any point, perhaps because you've left school or because you've left university, you can hop back on again at a later, be located at the right level, and then continue your journey to a higher level of proficiency. So it's very good at providing this scaffolding.
And I really like the idea that it's steps. So it's not one big jump. You can do it step by step.
Absolutely. And of course, as we know, learning goals need to be measured and assessed as you go along in order for progression to be made. But it's also quite important for schools or for society to be able to say, this is the level that's been reached after, I don't know, 10 years of education.
Right. And over here, you can see like a linear way from A1 all the way up to C2. But the companion volume has showed it in a different way. Can we take a look at how the
next
companion
slide?
Volume?
Yeah. Well, actually, the alternative metaphor than simply going upwards is an expansion of knowledge or growth and development, which takes place over time. So not only do you go upwards, but you expand your capacity, and it's really an educational model. And you can find that on page 34 of the new companion volume.
You're very good with the page numbers. How do you remember these?
I made a note before coming on screen.
Okay. All right. So if we look at the CEFR and the use of it inside the classroom and for the teacher and for the learner, what can we say to colleagues who are watching?
Well, it's very much an elaboration of the communicative approach to language teaching and learning, and which puts the communicative event at the heart of the teaching goal. It's called the action-oriented approach in the CEFR, and it's really a socio-cognitive model of learning. So if you look at the screen now, this slide, it shows on the right the context of use in the real world. This is really what we want our learners to be able to do, communicate effectively for their own purposes when they go out into the world. On the left, we have the learner herself as a person who is needing to develop through education strategies for communication, cognitive processes, and of course knowledge in order to be able to conduct herself in real world communication events. So by taking that real world and designing tasks based on the kind of can-do approach in the descriptors, we can create language learning events in learning contexts in the classroom, or perhaps mediated through digital technology, which develop communication skills. So it's not focusing on a repertoire of grammar or vocabulary, but on the tasks that need to be achieved with the vocabulary and grammar embedded within the task model.
So, and I think you're bringing back the learner to be at the core of all of this, and you're looking at the context and how the proficiency levels or the levels that are needed will vary from one context to the other.
Yeah.
Can I take you to tell us a bit more about actual like practical examples of using it inside the classroom and maybe one of your famous diagrams?
Well, I'd just like to just check if there's any questions coming up.
We've got Fauzi Bukris has asked, what's the volume of hours to cover per CEFR level? And do the textbooks really meet those CEFR levels?
Now, this is a very good question, yeah, because we put at the heart of our that previous diagram context. So this is not a question that can be answered simply, that if you're going from A1 to A2 or A2 to B1, that you must have a fixed number of hours. Really, it depends on the context of learning, who the learners are, right, what intensity of study they can do, both in the classroom and at home, or in some connected way outside of the classroom. Reducing it to hours, I think, is difficult. Clearly, though, the CEFR is very good for helping teachers and learners build their own organization of learning. So through their own experience, I think you with their learners, you work out what is likely to be effective. So mm-hmm. it's unlikely to be the case you can go from A1 to A2 in less than 100 teaching hours, for example.
Right. And Nick, if you remember, we used to, our research on learning gains, we used to recommend something, as you said, between 100 and maybe up to 200. But then I'd like also to focus on what Nick has said about the context, because it's not about the number of learning hours, it's about the intensity of it. Are you doing it like 10 hours a week? Are you doing it 3 hours a week? Are you doing it over a period of 6 months or over 4 months? What else is helping the acquisition of language? What is the home language like? What is the language within the school's walls? What is the language outside the school? Is it Malay? Is it Japanese? Does the learner only learn and hear English only inside the classroom? It's a very good question, but it's a hard one to give you a fixed response.
And one of the key drivers, of course, in any context is the language or languages the learner brings into the classroom. So linguistic distance, so Chinese script versus Roman script, was going to pose a big problem for many people in learning to read.
And going back also to Fauzi's, the other part of the question about do the textbooks really meet those CFR descriptors, my own personal view is that there wouldn't be one textbook that can meet all the needs of the learner and the teacher at a certain level. As a teacher inside the classroom, you look into various learning resources in order to get from one level to the next.
And that diagram I was showing before, it's actually to try and create a learning ecosystem which unites the world of the learner, her stage of learning, her capacity to learn, her prior knowledge, to the classroom and also to society and opportunities for learning outside of the classroom. Because we know that those who make most progress actually have the opportunity to use language beyond the classroom. 3 hours a week over a whole year may be very useful for some learners, but they barely scratch the surface for others.
True. You mentioned ecosystem. I'm hearing that term in various industries, including the education industry. Could you tell us a bit more about it and looking again at the CFR inside the classroom and yeah, assessment as well?
Well, an ecosystem is a system where all the parts actually work together in some kind of systemic way. So let's have a quick look at some slides we put together about a learning model. In the next, I think, we were just going to take a moment to summarize a few points before moving on to that.
Okay.
Perhaps we've made these points already. Hanan?
Yeah, on the next slide, what we wanted to show you are the benefits of the CFR, not this one, the next one. The fact that the CFR is language neutral, so it could be applied to any language. It's not just for Europe, it's all over the world at the moment. Another thing is that it also using the CEFR can do descriptors and illustrative skills can help with being multilingual or being plurilingual. It's very important to understand that it is not it's not fixed. It's not like a dictionary that you cannot move away from it, or like the Quran or the Bible. It's a framework, so it can be adapted to your local context. And actually, if you look at CFRJ, this is what Japan did. They took it and they applied it to the context. Malaysia at the moment is taking, again, looking at the CFR and the new companion and applying it to the Malay context. And these are some of the key advantages of the CFR, in addition to it being a learning ladder and looking at progression of the learner.
I'd just like to move on in a minute, but I've just spotted a very interesting comment by Melvin Davis, who has students who he thinks, he obviously pretty well motivated students, who can climb a CFR level in 6 months, spending a couple of hours in class and 30 minutes a day. I mean, I think there are people who can do that.
Absolutely.
But where I go around the world, quite often I find there's 50 or 60 children in a room, and they're in grade school and very mixed ability. And typically from the work we've done in doing benchmarking surveys and so on, we found that this is really not very, it's not very conducive to the majority of them making that kind of progress. So I think the one of the things that we're looking for in an ecosystem of learning, perhaps, is finding ways to tailor the learning more to the contextual parameters, aligning what learners can do in the classroom and supported by the teaching and materials which they have in their context, and indeed extending their learning beyond the classroom, like before, during, and after the class, increasingly with technology to provide the linking necessary to keep a group of people on track for their own learning goals, but while still being in a schooling context. So the learning ecosystem, perhaps we could come on to now with the diagram, which I think we've got next. Which has it stopped working?
No,
it's not showing. Okay,
I'm just checking to see if you wanted to have them all at once.
No, I'm just trying to see it on. It's come up on screen, but I can't actually see it. There we are.
Okay.
So what we have here is obviously the framework, the level system, providing with the learning objectives, the communicative goals, and other dimensions that form part of the learning curriculum, which then you can put into a course, which we can see is the next click, which then allows us to develop tasks for the classroom. So the task is actually at the center of this, and that allows you to create with the next click a series of activities which the teacher can observe, keep on clicking, interpret, record and somehow keep a record of, in order to make decisions about what to do in class and to modify the learning objectives. This is a typical learning and assessment cycle for classroom-based teaching and assessment. But what we're able to do with the ecosystem model is to ensure that what goes on in classrooms, which are focusing on learning goals, align to the records of achievement which we need for the school or for parents and others in the local context, or which are needed if you're going to take and pass internationally recognized exams. So the model is designed to favor learning at the center and to help people prove what they can do step by step, including getting to the point where they have a qualification. So it's moving away from the model of teaching, learning, and assessment where certain things go on in the classroom until it comes to preparing for the exam, where everybody starts doing exam practice and stops doing any learning. It's very common in many parts of the world.
But I also think what's quite important is the cyclical nature of the image that you have. So it doesn't just happen in a linear fashion. It's like you're monitoring what you are giving to the students, you're looking into the feedback, and then you are adapting and adjusting your teaching and your learning accordingly.
Now, there's a question here from Mariana Sanchez, which says, what do you think about the use of native language in the classroom? And that's a very interesting question, because in certain ways, you could only learn, you could only, certain contexts, you might only use the native language, because you can have the learners accessing the target language through technology. In fact, I've seen this in operation in some parts of the world where the teacher becomes a facilitator of the task rather than the provider of the model. But so I think it's increasingly likely that teachers will use several languages in the classroom.
And it's also about being practical. So instead of spending 10 minutes trying to explain one word, you can just say that word in the native language and you move on to something which is more important in the lesson rather than just one lexical item.
Yes, so I mean, what is depends again on context and level of the learners, the age of the learners. What puts the learners at their ease in engaging in activities, the task, the language activity, which facilitates learning. So which models communication, but which allows the teacher to control certain amounts of input and to observe what's going on in order to then adjust learning goals and remedial activities to scaffold the progression appropriately. So it is a community of language teaching model.
It is. And Nick, you've touched upon assessment and qualifications. Could you tell us how Cambridge English uses the CEFR in its product, in its Cambridge, its qualifications?
Well, yeah, going way back into the 1980s, in fact, we've used the kind of communicative model, originally the four skills, and the can-do approach to ensure that all of our exams have some form of task-based approach,
right,
including very much a focus on the productive skills. So a speaking test requires you to do speaking, and typically involving interaction and not just production. So the pair format, for example, has been based on that original model, which came out of the threshold level, actually, taking us way back. So we can see on the screen, in fact, that all of our exams now are aligned to the CEFR, and we've also developed our own scale, which allows us to report at a finer granularity the outcomes of learning. And also feedback, which can help learners focus on what they need to do next in their learning to improve. So it's very much a learning-oriented approach, I think.
What about aspirations that maybe policymakers would have when they think that by the time that you leave high school, you need to reach a certain level when the entry point is quite at a low level?
Well, I think there is a lot of policy which is made by declaration rather than reality, which, you know, the aspirations of policymakers is that, for example, at the end of high school, that learners will reach B2 level. The framework has been quite helpful, I think, in the last 15 years in policy context, in taking a realistic view of where learners are and where the system is with regard to outcomes. So the sort of surveys that have been done can show what the typical level of students is at the end of lower high school or indeed school leaving. Typically, it's one or two levels below where the policymakers would like. So if that is where they are now, the target, I think, if we clicked it, would see is more like two levels above. So I think with this has been quite helpful in revealing this to policymakers, so that in reform programs, realistic goals can be set for setting and monitoring standards over time, so that the standards can be raised. And there's a form of accountability in where the money's spent in helping to improve things.
Yes. And this is where, when we talk to policymakers, we talk about a language strategy, we talk about language goals, we look into the context, we do situation and analysis, and we do a baseline study so to understand where the levels are at the moment, so that we know where do we need to reach, where the students need to reach by the time they leave school, and how do we get there. Nick, our ongoing contribution to the CEFR.
Well, we're coming on next to talk about the companion volume, which you've been heavily involved in and which I was also somewhat involved in, including attending the launch conference earlier this summer in May, actually. We continue to do quite a lot of publishing, and I draw your attention to our English profile study series, which we publish with CUP. You've got quite a lot of articles in Research Notes. If you haven't seen it, there's one particular one which summarizes the contribution we made to the CEFR, to the companion volume. And we have our studies in language testing series, and I just wanted to use it as an opportunity to advertise this, our latest. It's called Examining Young Learners, Research and Practice in Assessing the English of School-Age Learners. And of course, as we will be discussing in a minute, one of the impacts most recently of the CEFR has been in helping to structure a curriculum for children. And increasingly where foreign language learning is becoming part of the elementary school curriculum, and that's certainly true for English. So this is quite an interesting approach. But I think it's now time to look at the what you're going to tell us about, Hanan, I hope, the companion volume, focusing on what's notable in terms of what's either new or what's different or additional compared with what we saw in the original.
Thanks, Nick. So I'm here today to talk to you about the new companion to the CEFR. What is really notable about it is that we bridge the gap in some of the illustrative scales. So usually the CEFR was criticized for not having enough descriptors at the lower levels or at the C levels. So that's what we have done with the new companion. The other thing is the move away, or not really the move away, it's going back and refocusing on the fact that the native speaker was never really intended to be a C2 level. What was intended for the C2 level is that you are a good communicator in English. The other thing was the introduction, or actually the elongation of scales on online interaction, given the fact that now we're all living in the digital world, as well as mediation. Also the introduction of young learners, illustrative scales, as Nick showed you in the book, at the CELT volume, we use some of those candor descriptors there. Before I go on, I know there has been lots of questions. I was wondering if we can just take a couple, if that's okay, yeah?
Well, I mean, I don't want to interrupt your flow, but I did spot a very interesting one, which I think is likely to be quite commonly found. It's is there anything, this is from Natalie McWolves. Is there anything that you could do for essay writing in EFL in the future? Here in Mexico, we're not taught how to write at all, not even in Spanish. Well, I think actually one of the strengths of the CEFR generally has been in this communicative approach, has been putting a focus on communicative skills in production, particularly speaking, but also writing. Writing's a difficult skill.
Yes.
Because it's something you need to learn in your first language as well as in another language. And as we see from this question, it's not often taught these days. But I think the can-do statements of the CEFR are very good in scaffolding reasonably accessible tasks from a low level and in increasing the complexity and therefore difficulty as you go up the level. And I'd like to point out that there are some very good online tools now to help people write and practice. One which we've been working on in Cambridge called Write and Improve. Have you heard about it?
Yes.
It's perhaps something we could get a link to.
Yes, one of our monitors will send you the link to Write and Improve, which is and actually a really good website for practicing writing.
Absolutely.
And Nick, if I may, Natalie, there's a couple of things. In Mexico, CEP Básico, the new curriculum, actually focuses on writing. So we're hoping that this will, by the time that you reach upper secondary levels, you'll be able to write essays. And if you take a look at CELT volume number 26, chapter 3 in particular, there's a very nice diagram that talks about cognitive processes that takes you through planning, drafting, redrafting. And if you do not want to read the book because it's, or if you want it for bedtime read, please go ahead. But that one diagram is quite indicative of how people write and the process that they go through. So I would recommend looking at that diagram.
And CEP in Mexico is using the CFR, right?
And CEP in Mexico is using the CFR. They're also, when we worked with them on the curriculum review, we looked into our construct volumes and the cognitive processing that goes into reading, listening, speaking, and writing. So fingers crossed that curriculum is being implemented and it will lead to change.
Is there another one here?
From Kushner.
Yes. Vyacheslav Kushner.
So, what is
well, that's a huge question. What do you think of using the CEFR descriptors as is in language assessment, for example, speaking or writing? I know they're used for this very purpose in some contexts, but descriptors do look a bit vague and underspecified, which I assume is inevitable on the one hand, but might lead to rather subjective interpretation on the other.
Yeah, well, that's a very good point about scale development. Mm. The illustrative scales of the CFR are not designed for assessment rubrics or rating scales as they stand. They provide the input to developing rating scales, but you need to go through a process of developing the scales for rating purposes. So those are user-oriented scales, you might call them, in the CFR. Well, what we need for assessment purposes are assessment-oriented scales, and they can be based on the same constructs or the same underlying communication goals, but they need to be tailored for the purposes of assessment.
And what you might be able to do as well, take a look at the toolkit on the Council of Europe, because there are illustrative examples of speaking and writing and of rubrics. I think there's one scale in the CFR that could be used if you're developing a rubric, and that's the pronunciation one. But you're better off looking at the illustrative examples on the Council of Europe website.
I mean, that's a really good point. That I think that they are called illustrative scales, which you can take and use as appropriate for your own purpose. They're not really in designed to be just taken and dropped in unchanged to any, they need to be changed for contextual relevance, and that's the main point, I think.
Okay.
Should we move on to look again at the companion volume? You were saying about what's notable. Should we just recap?
Yes, it's enriching the lower and upper levels, the new scales like the online interaction and mediation, a pre-A1 level and young learners, the addition of it, as well as the shifting back from or refocusing to the fact that it's C2 is not native speaker ability, but a good communicator at C2. And SJ, can we show the other one, the next one, next slide, please? Right, over here, this is a clear example that tells you that we're moving away from the native speaker to being a good communicator, and also looking at how the statements can be put forward in a very positive light. So we say, can understand with ease virtually instead of has no difficulty with any kind of spoken language, whether live or broadcast, delivered at fast, natural speed. You will notice that in the companion volume, the word native has gone. So again, the focus was being a communicator rather than being a native-like.
So that's at the top end of the scale. What about further down?
Right, let's take a look. SJ, please. Over here, you can see our pre-A1 level descriptors. And with the pre-A1, we looked at, while we were developing them, Nick, we looked at examples given from CFRJ, an example that we have used in Colombia and in different parts of the world, rather than Western Europe or in Europe, actually. where the script itself is a Roman script.
I see.
Which is quite interesting because it begs the question, where do you start on the learning ladder of the CEFR if, let's say, if you're a Japanese speaker or an Arabic speaker?
Or if you're an English person learning Chinese.
Yes.
So, I mean, this is for all languages, not just for people learning English. I know many of the people here today will be teaching English, but actually, you know, how much progression you make depends on where you start. We said that before.
Yes.
And the early stages can be quite daunting if you can't even understand anything when you try to read it. So it takes a lot longer to get to any proficiency in reading if the script is different.
Right. So I think with the PRIA one, it's about maybe using hand gestures or using formulaic expressions. I think that's where it's becoming a little bit clearer in the PRIA one.
Yeah, and I think it sort of allows us to develop an approach to language learning in classrooms, which is about developing communication skills rather than separating out things to be learned in a more atomistic way. So it would allow for code mixing, right?
It would allow for code mixing, and I think that answers one of the questions earlier about the using of the native language inside the classroom. I mean, there is nothing really wrong with using the native language in the classroom. I think what might be or might be seen as wrong is that if it's used all the time, because you cannot teach one language using the other language.
Well, it's very interesting you should say that, because I was at an event in Brussels in September at the European Commission, which was looking at the concept of three languages in school.
Right.
It was actually looking at a context in Spain where the young children coming into primary school, some of them speak Basque at home, some of them speak Catalan, and all of them are learning English from an early age. So they've created an environment for communication where the children are allowed to bring all three languages into school. And it's a very interesting approach, because it doesn't compartmentalize the learning in a classroom. It creates a whole school environment, a learning friendly environment for languages.
Encourages multilingualism,
but it also encourages the communication skills, which are very difficult to develop when constrained in a classroom.
Yes.
So it's very, very fascinating.
Right. And a couple of questions, sorry. So the question from Anna, how do we approach this pre-A1 level? I think one of the good things about the descriptors is that it is expressed in a very positive language, and it is quite simple and short. I think that's quite motivational. So whatever you do at the pre-A1 level, it has to be motivational, whether you're using games inside the classroom, the choice of your learning resources, how you're communicating inside the classroom. That's all aids into moving students, learners along from pre-A1 to A1. Nick, anything from your side on that?
Well, actually, I've just been spotting another question here where you've been talking from Brian Castaneda, which is, would you recommend explaining the CEFR to students who will take the YLE test? Well, I don't actually recommend explaining the CEFR to many people who are not professionals. But I do think you can use some of what they call the apparatus from the CEFR in order to get learners, including younger learners, to understand what the goals are of learning and then to sort of monitor themselves for whether or not they're achieving that. So some of you may remember that at the same time as the CEFR was published in 2001, there was a launch of something called the European Language Portfolio, which was designed as a tool for learners. So instead of can-do statements, they recast them in a way to be used by learners, which is, I can do something.
Right.
And their goal was to create a portfolio of things they could do. So in assigning learning goals, there was a kind of conversation with learners about what it is they were trying to learn and whether or not they could do them as a result of the activities in the classroom. So it might be worth checking that. I think there's still resources for that on the Council of Europe website. So ways in which the can-do statements can be helpful in helping learners to understand learning goals.
But I also think, Brian, that one of the things that you can tell your students or your young learners is the fact that the CEFR is a learning ladder. And none of us could be very good in speaking, reading, English, reading, listening, and writing. You would have a jagged profile. So it would be quite important to explain that, that one student might be good in speaking, might need to improve in reading, for example.
There is a quite an interesting question here from the Global Academy, which is, do you have any suggestions for in-service English teachers whose English is still below B2? How could they both improve their language proficiency and teaching methodology in parallel? It's been quite a major issue in Indonesia.
I think it's quite a major issue in many parts of the world, particularly as we go down to teaching English in primary school, that many of the teachers themselves who are trained as primary school teachers don't have language skills to a very high level. I think the obviously there is there are resources for teachers to help them improve both their proficiency and their capacity to use the community of language teaching model in classrooms. Quite a lot of that comes from our website and what we curate ourselves. I think the idea of finding ways in which you can supplement your own lack of proficiency, we mentioned it before, using technology as a way forward, and guiding learners to access technology, which provides the learning context or the learning content on behalf of the teacher. And it really is one of the things I would recommend that teachers begin to do, which is not to see technology as something that is coming to take their jobs away, but something which is going to go sort of hand in hand with them to help them resolve some of these problems. So,
and also one of the things that we offer, and I don't know if Global Academy is aware of this, is that we have a course which is blended learning for in-service teachers who are teaching primary and in-service teachers who are teaching secondary as well. You might want to look it up. It's called Certificate in English Language Teacher Teaching Primary, CELT-P and CELT-S. That's one thing. Of course, we do have the webinars that they can improve their methodology as well. The other thing that you might wish to think about is, what is the incentive for teachers to improve their teaching and their language proficiency? And that's a question for policymakers and school leaders, for example, because as a teacher, they have lots of things that they need to do, and to improve their language proficiency may not tie up on their priority ladder.
One of the things we did a few years ago now was to introduce TKT as a way of helping people address the more or less the methodological side of it, without having to attend sort of in-service training courses. And I think some of the materials that are available for to support TKT are really good for helping address the methodological gaps that teachers may have if they weren't trained as teachers of languages in their original training. But it is a big issue, and I think a big problem in many parts of the world.
It is.
Right, shall we carry on?
Yes.
Where are we next?
I think we were still.
I think we've done the pre-A1 level, so that's one of the new companion looked at the lower levels and tried to enrich them. Also enriching the higher levels, the C levels, and what you're seeing on the screen are scales or descriptors for listening as a member of a live audience and reading for information and argument. And we picked this specifically to show you that there has been also a focus on higher education and the higher education context, looking at internationalization of higher education and the fact that you might wish, and most universities now are teaching in the medium of English, so English as a medium of instruction. The focus here, for example, in listening could be about note-taking, and you'll see the difference in the, I don't know if you can see the fonts. So the blue font is the new companion. The black font is from the older version of the CEFR. If you look at reading for information and argument, this is really what a student in the HE sector would do. They would read several articles. They would try to evaluate it, and they would try to put together an argument based on the desk research that they have done. So again, that was included in the new companion. I just want to say something here about the new companion. It really, it took us 4 years to put it together. And it took, thank you, Nick. And it took at least 3,000 teachers and practitioners worldwide to feedback on the descriptors and to validate it and to calibrate it. So there are lots of work that has gone in there.
You need a good photocopier to print it out. It's quite thick, but I printed this one out earlier today, and it is really very accessible. I'm just reminding myself of it, and it's got this very interesting diagram on page 32. And yes, we're going to come on and talk about that next time.
Yes, we are.
Page 32. It's I mentioned earlier that it had in the original CFR the skills broken down into reception and production. Mm-hmm. So the reading and listening is reception, and production is speaking and writing. Interaction, which of course is incredibly important, which is people who are listening and speaking together, or possibly where you're reading and writing, so integrating skills. And then something which is called mediation, which is sort of hanging off this side of the diagram, which mm-hmm. is found in the original one, but for which you'll find very little in right. the 2001 volume. And there may have been many reasons for that at the time, but that was one of the focuses of our yes. Work on the new companion
yes,
volume,
and
right?
SJ just pulled it out. So new skills for mediation, it is definitely a complex process. And because the learner is acting as the social agent, and the learner is the one who's creating bridges between either the text and someone else who's reading that text, or between two individuals. If you look at also the different types of mediation, SJ, next one, please.
The three types.
Mm. This is what we focused on in the companion volume. So mediating text, this is where the learner would look at a graph or a set of data and try to interpret it in a linear fashion. If you look at mediating concepts, for example, it's taking quite a complex or abstract concept and trying to make someone else understand that concept. If you look at mediating communication, it's the famous go between two people.
Yeah, and we're not talking about, you know, needing to be at C2 level to be an interpreter. No. We're talking about someone who's more knowledgeable.
Yes.
Helping someone else to understand. So it's a really interactive communication model. Mm-hmm. And it's I think it offers some very interesting possibilities for designing new integrated tasks, or for indeed more integrated test types in the future.
It does, and it also takes us really back to the idea that the CFR is action oriented, that communication is at the heart of the CFR.
Right, yeah.
If you want to know more about mediation, we are doing a session on the 5th of December
Great.
About mediation, and it will be another Facebook Live about that. So make sure you watch our page and our wall to find out when it's going to take place, exactly what time, and who's going to be running it. But it'll be another expert, and they'll talk about mediation in a lot more detail.
Okay, so we won't dwell on it anymore
no.
today.
Yeah.
We might look and see if there's any more questions before we move on to some other
we've
points.
We've got one here from Deanna Bradford. Are there any plans for expanding the CEFR English qualifications beyond for schools, general education, and business? For example, adding English for aviation or English for medical purposes?
Good point. I think, the answer about aviation is not at the moment. Obviously, we have some collaboration around the occupational English test for mm-hmm. medical purposes, which is a very interesting task-based approach. But I think as we move forward, generally speaking, the era of specific purposes testing can become, shall we say, come into its own, because mm-hmm. one of the issues which prevented specific purpose testing developing further in the 80s and 90s were practical constraints sure. in developing and delivering tests which were very specific to particular types of learner. Mm-hmm. But with computer mediated or delivered assessments and the ability to understand and provide a focus on a particular context of learning and assessment, we can, I think, develop in the future a range of particular tests for particular needs, which will be practical and affordable and all the rest of it, which are going to be necessary if they're going to work properly.
But also, Nick, if you look at ICAO for aviation, I mean, the way that they have illustrated the descriptors, again, they're using the concept of the CEFR, that it is divided into different levels and it has can-do descriptors as well. So you might you may wish to look at ICAO's standards.
Well, definitely, there are many specialist bodies who are adapting the CEFR to their own context. Whether it's feasible to develop tests is often, as I said, a practicality question as much as anything else. But I would look forward to more of that and more interesting and integrated types of task. You can imagine a scenario for a seminar, which, you know, starts with a reading activity, goes into some form of mediated seminar activity, leading to a written activity, leading to an oral presentation. It's it's the way of the world for much of what goes on in education.
Right. I think, can we just go down a bit, because there was a question about IELTS and the C levels.
Yes. By from Liliana Rodriguez.
Yes.
Why students who present the IELTS achieve a level of C1 or C2, but they still feel that they do not belong to this level in a real context, for example, living in an English-speaking country?
Yeah.
Can I say that from my own personal experience?
You did you take IELTS?
I'm Fifth Amendment to that one. No, because when I first came to the UK, it took me a while actually to train my ears to listen to the accent. So even though I thought that I was a good listener, tuning in into a little accent or to to a Londoner or to a Manchester accent, that took me a while. Yeah. Also, on any exam, whether it's IELTS, TOEFL, PTE, it is a snapshot of your skill at a particular moment in time in your life, and it's not the broad spectrum. So that wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, I mean, many people who come to the UK attend a pre-sessional course, even if they've got an IELTS 6.5 or indeed 7 sometimes, in order to acclimatize.
Yes.
And I think that acclimatization is really important when moving into another country, another, when it's not just languages, lots of cultural and other things you have to learn.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, I think exams are a general predictor. All other things being equal, and when you get there, they're not equal. There are lots of things which take you by surprise.
We are running out of time, but I wanted to point this one out. You were talking earlier about using TKT, and Global Academy has this response. And we've shared the link to TKT, and I just wanted to share that.
Thank you, Global Academy. Take a look at CELT-P and CELT-S as well.
Yeah, I mean, these tools are definitely designed, as Hanan was hinting, at helping people who are busy teachers.
Yes.
People who can't give up, you know, a year to go and study abroad or go back to university. And I think that's what we're trying to do with many of our resources, including our online webinars and MOOCs and so forth.
Right. I don't know how we're doing in terms of time, but there's one more scale.
Can we come back with the one more scale or two? Is it anyway? Can we go back and just finish?
Yes. So I've got the slide up for new skills for use of language online.
Yeah, yes. You mentioned the concept of all online interaction and new skills in that domain.
Yes, and actually, it was one of our colleagues, one of the expert members of the panel, Tim Goodyear, had to be in his bonnet about online interaction and about. I mean, we're living in the age of digital literacy. So how do we integrate that into teaching and learning? How could we expand the online interaction skills to include blogs and chatting? And do we include, like, if you're SMSing?
Instagram.
If you're SMSing, How are you going to mark that? Can that be part of the can-do descriptors? I mean, there were lots of lively debates, believe me, on the online interaction, but it's one of the new things in the new companion, and it's quite interesting to look at.
We've only had the smartphone for just over 11 years. So it clearly wasn't something which was taken into account so much in the original CFR.
Well, the things that we can do with the smartphone now, though, has really only taken off very, very recently.
I think so. And actually, it's one of the things which is so exciting about how you can connect learning within and outside of the classroom if we get smart at it.
Yes, definitely.
Because, I mean, it's a fact of life. The kids are going to have them all.
But also, I mean, one of the things that we keep saying that even though digital is here to stay, we cannot assume that teachers can actually use digital gadgets, and we cannot assume that teachers also have been trained on how to incorporate digital into their classrooms. We're advocating continuous professional development for teachers, whether they are in service or included as part of the modules in pre-service.
So we have the scales which are representing the things that people now do with these things, at least if you're a millennial or a Generation Z.
Yes.
Teachers may have to, some of us older baby boomers may need to get up to speed with it.
So I've got here goal-oriented online transactions and collaboration. So are these some of the things that tasks and activities we can do?
Yes. And I think some of that would have existed in, in a learning resource, but I think it's now that it has been pulled out and highlighted, it might appear more.
These are sort of transactions which would have been done in the analog world of face-to-face or in a shop or so on. But nowadays, they are increasingly done online. And that's how many people just live their lives. Right?
True.
So I think this is just facing up to the reality. And what about this new can-do This is an example, is it?
It is an example of the new descriptor. So can complete a very simple online purchase or application providing basic personal information. I want to say something about the purchase is easier because you're just a click of a button and you can press to purchase. But if you are at a lower level, how do you fill out an application form and actually understanding whether it's a big font or a small font, the caps, etc.
What do you think our listeners think this level is?
Oh, yeah. What do you guys think? Tell us.
I wonder. There's a bit of a giveaway there with the word very simple.
Yes. There is a... Yep. We'll have to give people a little bit of time for the comments to come through. But in the meantime, while everyone's looking at it and wondering what level this might be, there are a couple of questions that we can answer.
Thank you for all these questions.
Yes,
very interesting.
Loads.
Sorry, we can't answer all of them. So did you spot one, SJ, that you thought would, as you scroll down?
Deanna actually responded to our answer. And she's replied saying, thank you for answering my question. At the university I currently work at, I have noticed an increase in requests from external stakeholders to create more English for specific purposes courses, like aviation law. You're right, you're absolutely right. Standardizing the English used in these areas, I believe, is becoming more and more important.
I think for adult learners who are already qualified in, perhaps they have their first degree or I then think of going on to train after they've gone into a workplace and then moving on. In order to be selected for a particular domain, it's not so much the proficiency level, it's more that's, do you remember the picture of the blue ball?
Yes.
It's more like that expansion of knowledge, recycling for more specific, more complex, more... where the vocabulary and concepts are very different than you'd expect to find in daily life, where employers are looking for someone who's actually got that.
Yes.
So learning and teaching and then assessment around it is becoming increasingly a differentiator for people needing to be employed in specific industries.
Yeah, but also, I mean, I don't know the context that Diana is working in, but here is an assumption. So if you're working in a context where English is the medium of instruction or so-called medium of instruction, you might get a request from a lecturer who's delivering the business or who's working in the business school to say, right, I do not want to have your general English. I want the English that is focusing on business interaction, on the different negotiation skills into business. My response to this would be, A, you need to get the language level, the general English proficiency of the students right first before you can move into much more English for specific purposes, really, that will impact positively on a business student.
Yeah, I think we've got some answers in.
Most people are saying A2.
We've got A1 plus.
A1 plus?
I was just looking at it myself, and apart from the fact you can, in fact, once you understand the instruction, you can complete it by just clicking. So there's the understanding the instruction is probably the more difficult bit. And then the actual information is very simple. Your name, email address, and number. So you have to be proficient in the script.
You have to be able to write in that script.
But otherwise, I would say A1 myself for that.
I would agree. Because let's take a look. It's very simple. Yeah. So the keywords are very simple. Basic personal information. So imagine yourself learning, like for me, learning German, for example, and I do not speak a word of German, but I should be able to say my name, my email address, and my telephone number at an A1 level.
But you're very proficient in English, so you can read the German, at least.
I can read the script.
The alphabet.
Yes, the alphabet.
It would be more difficult if it was in Chinese.
I hesitated because I was going to say Chinese, but Chinese would take me years to master it, actually.
So, I mean, these are illustrative descriptors.
It is.
And yeah, they're not, before you use them definitively for any purpose, you have to understand what they represent in the context of teaching and learning that you're setting.
Yeah.
So it may be slightly more difficult for some people, this, I would say. But I personally think it's pretty much an A1.
But I mean, if the context is like you're pressing a button on online purchase, all you have to know is you're recognizing that this is a dress that I want to buy, and this is the price, click. And I've completed that transaction.
Well, Well, thank you very much for taking the time to talk to us on the CEFR and the companion volume. As you can tell, I mean, we've had a lot of interest and a lot of questions have come in. We're really sorry we can't get to everybody's questions today, but thank you so much for joining us. And thank you so much for sharing your experience and knowledge.
I really enjoyed it.
Thanks, SJ.
Thank you for your questions. There are many more there.
And thank you for your time and watching us.
If you joined us halfway or came in a bit later, don't worry. You'll get an opportunity to watch this right from the beginning. So, because it's being recorded and we'll post it on our wall. And for those of you who are watching on Instagram, do come over to Facebook because we've got all the comments and all the questions and all the slides will be there as well. So it'd be a great opportunity to see the whole thing in the full experience.
Right.
Don't forget, on the 5th of December, we also have a session on mediation. So if that's something that you really want to get into, that's a good session to come to. So make sure you follow us or like us so that you get a reminder of when the next session is going to be. All the details for getting your digital badges are on the wall from one of our moderators. So make sure you just scroll through and you will find the link to the site where you can get your digital badge, as well as the code that you will need in order to claim it. Again, thank you all for joining us today, and thank you both.
Looking forward to being back again sometime soon.
I just want to say hello to some of the names that I'm recognizing. So hello to those who know me. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. See you again soon.
Bye. Have a good day.